Paul Tremblay, the horror thriller author who completely blew me away with Head Full of Ghosts, slightly disappointed me with The Disappearance at Devil's Rock, but brought it all back to something that was truly a unique reading experience with The Cabin at the End of the World, has written a new book called Survivor Song. And much like the film I reviewed, She Dies Tomorrow, this is a bit prophetic. And what I mean by that is it's eerily relevant to the times we currently find ourselves in. One thing to note about Paul Tremblay's work is one of my favorite things about him is his ambiguous endings. Now, those aren't for everyone. Clearly, a lot of people like things explicitly spelled out for them. They like everything wrapped up at the end. But for me, that's a little bit less interesting. I really love what he's done with his novels and playing with the ending almost going one of two ways. And it's up to the reader to contemplate those two decisions and decide maybe if one seems a little bit more plausible than the other. And other than that, he's a fantastic writer. He really immerses you into the story at a breakneck pace and puts compelling characters in interesting situations. If you haven't checked out his work, I highly suggest it. Start with Head Full of Ghosts. That's my favorite. That will give you a good idea of what to expect from his work. Let's move on to Survivor Song. So what is this book about? Well, a rabies-like virus has spread like wildfire through Massachusetts. It's been infecting animals and people. But the difference is with rabies, as you may know or may not know, wherever the bite location is, the virus slowly creeps up something like a centimeter per day until it reaches your brain, and then at that point it's over. This one, however, has a very short incubation period of only like an hour or so. So what ensues next is more or less what you'd expect from a zombie-like situation, and yes, there are foaming mouths. We follow two protagonists. We have Natalie, who is a pregnant woman who's recently been bitten, and she reaches out to her college friend named Romola, who is a doctor, for help. Natalie has lost her husband in an attack by one of these infected people in an amazing opening scene that I am convinced will hook you. The clock is ticking. Is she infected? Is she going to get the vaccine in time? Is her baby safe? That is the ride you're in store for. So what did I think? Well, let's start with characters. As I said, we have Natalie, who's a pregnant woman, recently lost her husband. She is sassy, sarcastic, salty, and I can't say that I was in love with her personality type, but she does provide a nice contrast to Romola, who is more reserved, logical, less emotional, and so I think it works. We're presented with a lot of backstory that gives us all the information we need to know about the relationship. Unfortunately, it's very expository, but I'll get into that later in the review. But regardless, we can see that there's a genuine friendship there. There's a very close relationship, and they seem to lean on each other in different ways throughout the story. The downside is, however, I didn't really feel for them. I didn't get invested in either of them, even though there are some highly emotional situations in the story that really would have pulled me deeper into these characters' heads if I feel like that groundwork had been laid successfully. But there are two characters, these young boys, I don't want to get into it too much, but they, Romola and Natalie, meet these young boys, I want to say somewhere maybe mid through the novel. And I love those guys. They provide a great comic relief. There's a lot of movie references, and they even go into like zombie tropes. And I think their arc was far more compelling to me anyway, and it could be because I'm nostalgic, I'm a kid of the 80s, and their personalities and actions really, really hit home with me. And I was really impressed with what Tremblay did in the short amount of time that they were in the novel. All right, now let's move on to the plot. Now there's a great Fury Road reference. If you haven't seen the movie Mad Max Fury Road, it may not make much sense to you, but once I started thinking about it, if you know about the plot of that film, we have Furiosa, played by Charlize Theron, escorting these pregnant women of Immortan Joe across this wasteland with all of these forces just trying everything they can do to stop them. Does that sound familiar? Yes, it does. We have Romola, pregnant woman, being led by her best friend Romola to save the baby and save themselves. So I really love that touch. It was a very story within a story, and if you have seen the film, I think you'll get a lot more out of that. There's really not a lot of plot elements. The story takes place over only a few hours, so we're racing against the clock. We know the incubation period of this virus is really short, and Natalie has little hope to survive. So think of this as a breakneck thriller with a simple plot, very character-driven, and a small cast of characters. I feel like the one downside of the plot is that there could have been more encounters with these infected people. The ones that are there are great. I really enjoyed the way the author handled the infected here. They're not really your standard zombies. I mean, they're barking these weird, meaningless words, almost rhyme-like nonsense, which to me in the beginning felt like he was playing with the idea of a fairy tale, which plays a big part in this story. And the very opening talks about fairy tales and how this is not your standard fairy tale. This is not your sugar-coated Disney fairy tale. I just really wanted more. But that said, it's not like a huge downside to the story. We're still given enough conflict here to keep things interesting. All right, now let's talk about the writing or the cinematography of the story, the soundtrack of the story, the somewhat invisible thing that may compel you to keep going or just stop you in your tracks completely. Paul Tremblay writes in present tense. Now, that has become very popular in recent years. I think it started mostly with young adult novels, but now we're seeing it pop up all over the place. And I've heard that people use that because they're looking for a sense of immediacy, something that maybe the past tense doesn't provide, even though that the past tense format is very ingrained in our brains. And honestly, when I'm reading past tense, I'm not necessarily thinking about it as something that has happened. Those kind of things just blur away into the background, and I'm very invested with the story. Present tense doesn't bother me at all, but if that's something you're against, it may be a little bit jarring to your reading ear. Now, the one thing that did slow me down is the exposition here. So we are told the story of Romola and Natalie's relationship through just long exposition dumps. For the most part, we get a little bit in character and dialogue, but a lot of their backstory is just told to us. And I think that was kind of one of the failings of the character development, is that it didn't really invest me hearing a story told that way or the backstory of a character told that way at such lengths. And it also somewhat contrasts with the fast-paced nature of the novel, as well as it being told in present tense. And I'm not saying it's completely bad. It's just that it really did stand out to me because the rest of the novel is very frenetic and you're literally told everything beat by beat, which is what I'd like to talk about next. So when I say beat by beat, I mean every little detail, moment by moment, we're given through the story. And I think that contributes to the fact that we don't have a lot of time, so we're noticing all these micro details. Sometimes it might be too much detail for people. We usually want a little bit of exposition to kind of past the time, so to speak, and we don't really see much of that here. But I don't really feel like it detracted from the experience, really. I felt like it served what the story was trying to do and the pace it was trying to present. One interesting thing about the descriptions here, and this may not stand out to most of you, but me as a writer, it really did, is that he would paint the picture almost like a laundry list of every person you met. So what I mean by that is we meet person A, and it's like, John is 6 feet tall with black hair, wearing a blue shirt, and has green eyes. Just a laundry list of descriptive stuff that I felt didn't really need to be there. I mean, normally what writers tend to do is they want to pepper those throughout a scene. So you're learning what this character sounds like, what they look like, what they act like, while you're in an immediate scene, not at the very front end of it. Once again, not a terrible thing. It just stood out to me. And it's personally something I try to avoid in my writing, but it may not bother you. Now, the way this novel is broken up is interesting. It's essentially two POVs. We get Natalie and we get Romola. But the chapters are really, really long. And I'm curious what the thought process was for that, because I felt like with a novel like this, it would have benefited from short chapters, just bouncing between Romola and Natalie just to almost enhance the quick pace of the novel. So that was a bit of a detraction for me. However, what I love about his writing, as I mentioned early on in the review, is he plays a lot with modern formatting. There are some, I don't want to spoil anything, but there are some chapters where one of the characters is literally dictating something to another on a mobile device. And I love that. It strips away the normal narrative. It's a flow of dialogue. And I felt like it really got you in the moment in that character's head. And also he plays around with things like text messages and Facebook posts. So it's a nice visual breakup of writing rather than having paragraph, 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 dialogue quotes, dialogue quotes, dialogue quotes. One thing I really love about it is the white space it creates, and it creates a visual pace all its own. So you have pacing in story and you have a visual pacing because you're visually reading this stuff. And playing with those formats really helps a lot, I think. And it's especially effective toward the end, and I'm not going to get into it, but it's kind of reminded me a little bit of the novel House of Leaves. Not nearly to that extent, because that played with composition and all kinds of things. Nevertheless, I really like how that was done for effect at the very end. So finally, the ending. Did it present an ambiguous Paul Tremblay signature end? Sadly, not really. I think that this story is a very straightforward story. So, hey, I mean, if you're into everything being kind of buttoned up, you're going to like this one. If maybe his other novels or other novels you've read in the past from different authors have been a little bit too ambiguous, you don't need to worry about that here. You're given everything you need to know about the characters and the ending, and there's really nothing questionable about the resolution here. All right. Should you read it? Well, if you're looking for a signature Paul Tremblay horror thriller, I feel like it's lacking a little bit in a few departments. It's by no means a terrible novel. It's exciting and interesting, and I think he presented an infection that felt believable and something we hadn't quite seen yet. But as I mentioned, it lacked a little bit of the character development that I loved in his other novels, and it lacked a little bit of the ambiguity and the resolution of his other novels, but it was still enjoyable. Now, if you're just hungry for a new thriller, you're out of books to read, you can't go wrong here. This provides everything I think you're looking for in a thriller, but brought to you in a package that I believe only this author can give. All right, now time for the review score. So if Head Full of Ghosts was a 9 out of 10, The Disappearance at Devil's Rock was something like a 6 out of 10, and The Cabin at the End of the World was like an 8 out of 10, I'm going to have to firmly put Survivor Song at a 6.5 out of 10. It had a compelling hook. I was really hoping for something a little bit deeper here. And while the reading wasn't a chore and the characters were pretty interesting for the most part, I didn't feel like I really connected with all of them enough to add that extra layer of investment. And of course, the straightforward resolution was a bit of a disappointment for me. And really, I only say that because he's presented such great endings in his other novels. And here I feel like it's once again, it's not bad. I feel like the best books are the ones that make you think days and months and even years after you finish the last page. And while there's a lot of things I respect about this book, I can't say it's going to stick with me for very long. But thank you, Paul Tremblay, for this great new novel. It didn't quite tick all the boxes for me, but I had a good time with it. I can't wait to see what you come up with next. And thank you for watching. And if you'd like to see me create and not just critique, and you're into storytelling or writing or anything like that, you might be interested in my series, Worth 1,000 Words, where I test the old adage, is a picture worth 1,000 words? And I write a 1,000 word short story on the spot based on a piece of artwork. And that's it for me. I'm done. Thanks again for watching, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.